Thanks, Ajita. It's wonderful to be here. As mentioned, my name is Jason King. I'm the CFO of Smartgroup. Really appreciate the opportunity today to be here presenting. I thought for those of you who aren't necessarily familiar with Smartgroup's business, I'll start by giving a little bit of background on who we are and what we do. And then I'll delve a little bit deeper into, I guess, current priorities for the business and current performance, as well as financial outcomes, having recently announced our half yearly result. And then looking forward to questions at the end also. So by way of background, Smartgroup, in essence, is a salary packaging and novated leasing provider in Australia. We're a 100% Australian-owned business, and we provide these services to a range of different clients and customers in the Australian market. Many of those clients are in relatively stable defensive sectors, such as government, education, healthcare, and not-for-profit. And we also service the corporate sector as well, and that is an increasingly growing part of our business. The services that we offer essentially derive from allowances that many industries have under salary packaging to optimize people's take-home pay through different tax benefits that they may be entitled to. And these benefits vary reasonably by industry, so they're quite complex and quite varied. But by and large, by customers using our services to salary package, they're able to increase their take-home pay and take advantage of other benefits that we offer. We tend to be what you would call a B2B2C business. So we have very close relationships with our client employers. And through those relationships, we seek to distribute our products to customers. We're very aligned with our employers as clients, because one of the reasons why they like our service is because by allowing people to maximize their take-home pay and to take on other benefits, we're really assisting them in improving the employee affinity, the engagement that they have with their employees. And so in that respect, we're very closely aligned with them when we're distributing our services. We primarily earn revenue through a couple of different ways. So we charge administration fees for the salary packaging on the one hand, and also administration fees for other aspects of our business, including vehicle fleet management, which is one aspect of what we do. And then separately, we have transaction style revenue that we earn from things like the administration and the processing of novated leases, which is a reasonably important part of our business. We have over 4,000 clients across a range of different sizes and sectors. And we have over 400,000 active employees at the packaging with us at present. Now, that's out of a potential pool of 2 million customers. If we look at the number of employees that each of our clients have, it's a relatively large number. So we're currently servicing a good proportion, but there is definitely opportunity for us to increase penetration into the existing customer base and grow our business in that respect. We are more recently, due to some introduction of additional allowances for tax benefits associated with electric vehicles, what we're finding is that has also created some momentum behind the business, particularly within the corporate sector, but also more broadly, as it's now possible for us to package through a novated lease electric vehicles at essentially pre-tax, using essentially pre-tax income. So we would summarize our investment proposition to investors probably along the following lines. We're essentially a leading player in our chosen markets, so those markets being salary packaging, novated leasing, and fleet vehicle management. We've got long-standing relationships with clients. They tend to be very long contracts in the sectors that we play in. We have a capital light business model, which helps us when it comes to risk management. And we have a favorable trading environment at present, particularly with the introduction of electric vehicles. We also have a very clear direction in terms of seeking to simplify our business. And since listing the business in 2014, we've had a very good record, a track record of growth. Just as a quick example, if we look at one sector, which is the charity sector, a charity employee is using salary packaging benefits has the opportunity to take out some of their living expenses pre-tax. What that effectively amounts to, as you can see an example here comparing left with right, is an after-tax saving or an after-tax increase in their take-home pay of 17%. So this is relatively compelling. And what that means for our business is that it's most often not about us convincing customers of the proposition, but really just educating them on what's available. We have a customer education and marketing team that focuses on doing that. And a lot of our business development activity is that way inclined because the proposition itself is reasonably compelling. As I mentioned before, electric vehicles are now able to be taken out using a novated lease and done so with pre-tax dollars. And this is a very significant saving for people looking to buy a new vehicle or upgrade their existing vehicle. This has created a lot of momentum behind our business. At present, electric vehicles are contributing around about 42% of orders in the business as at the end of the most recent half that we reported on. And that is also balanced by growth we've had in the other part of the business, which we call the internal combustion engine or ICE part of the business. But we have been seeing good momentum in order growth across the board. It's worth noting that one of the aspects of the policy, which is plug-in hybrids, is up for review and may come to an end in April 2025. That is currently about 10% of our business. And we'll be looking to see what we can do to retain those types of customers and find them either a battery electric vehicle or even a novated lease for their existing plug-in hybrid, because novated leasing will still be available for plug-in hybrids, if not the the generous tax concessions. Delving now into the historical financial performance of the company, we recently announced our half-yearly result. We're very pleased with the result we've achieved. We're very comfortable with the progress we're making on our strategic priorities. So that for the half year of FY24 to June this year, we announced $148.5 million of revenue, $56.2 million of EBITDA, and $34.1 million of NPATA. These are relatively strongly up on the prior half, prior comparable period. With revenue being up 27%, EBITDA is up 20%, and NPATA is up 16%. I would note that we had one very significant client win during the period, which was announced late last calendar year, and we've been working very closely with the South Australian government to implement the services for them. That's something that we successfully delivered very recently in the start of July. Those numbers aren't reflected here because it's only recently come on, but in respect of the implementation costs, we did incur around about $3 million of implementation costs in the first half. And that was without having at that point any associated revenue. By and large, the good performance here was driven by increased vehicle orders and also some improvements in the amount of revenue that we earned per order from some initiatives that we undertook last year and that we're able to maintain through the current first half. I'll turn briefly now to our philosophy around capital management. This is reasonably simple, but we do maintain a very disciplined approach to capital management. And that is, in essence, we focus on ensuring that our core business plan and our transformation activities are fully funded. We retain some flexibility to invest in new digital initiatives, potential other organic growth opportunities, and potential inorganic growth opportunities if the situation arises for something that is attractive. But beyond that, we have a stated policy of paying 60 to 70% of NPATA back to shareholders as fully franked dividends. And in the past, and something that we do consider, is where we do have excess capital, we seek to return those to shareholders by way of special dividend or other returns. Through the combination, I guess, of your really good financial management, strategic management, and capital management, we've been able to demonstrate strong returns for shareholders. Since the listing of the company in 2014, as you can see on the chart here, capital growth for the company has been very strong. And we've also had a good track record in terms of paying dividends and franking on those dividends. So over 750% total shareholder return during the period. And this is something we stay very focused on. We have a very disciplined approach to capital. And we think we've done a good job in terms of growing the business since listing. I'll move on now to the strategic priorities. So what are we focused on at the moment? So our stated strategy for the business is to build smarter benefits for a smarter tomorrow. And this comes in, I guess, three pillars. So we're looking at having smarter experiences. That's for both our clients and our customers. And they're underpinned by what we call smarter products. So very much focused on simplifying and innovating on our product suite to improve the customer experience and also improve the operating efficiency in the background. And then working smarter. So this is more of the internally focused initiative, looking to, again, simplify our business and maintaining Smartgroup as a fantastic place to work. The current strategic priorities are underpinned by four pillars. So we are looking to enhance our digital offerings. So we want to improve our salary packaging offering through enhanced digital experience, and also ensuring that digital enables us to be more efficient in our processing and thereby grow the business in a more cost-effective manner. We're looking to establish ourselves as a leader in the novated leasing market, particularly with electric vehicles, which is a large and growing part of our business and one where we feel we've got a competitive advantage. We will continue to try and adapt to evolving customer needs, and we look at other ways that we can add additional products to our benefits offering or additional additions to the ecosystems that we plan. And then we're going to continue to maintain our investment in fleet capabilities. Our fleet business is a smaller part of our business, although generates very good returns. And we're going to continue to maintain that in a relatively focused sense. As far as how we're tracking against these priorities, in particular for the first half, we feel we've made good progress in the longer-term strategic priorities while delivering the result for the first half and getting the right balance between current returns and also the investment program for future returns that should pay off over the next 2 to 3 years. So we've delivered an enhanced car leasing portal, which is a revised digital experience, which we think gives greater customer centricity and more efficiency, and we're looking forward to continuing to evolve on that front. We're looking forward to adding new partnerships to the salary packaging benefits offering, having added a couple of major partnerships throughout the first half of 2024. As I stated before, a lot of work went into delivering the South Australia government contract, and now we're working very closely with that government to ensure that we can make known the benefits that we have for all South Australian government employees, improve our penetration with that client and uplift our revenue. And then more broadly, in respect of working smarter, there has been a fair amount of change in the business recently. We've undertaken an operating model reset to really refocus some aspects of what we do more towards technology. And we've delivered a number of operational process improvements, including the first delivery of various Gen AI tools across the business in the operations areas. And then finally, part of the stated strategy that we had was to simplify our business wherever possible. And this included ensuring that we've got absolute focus on the core business. And so we made a disposal of two very small add-on businesses during the half to increase that level of focus. I've touched already on the financial performance, but as I mentioned, this is underpinned by really good customer outcomes. We've increased the number of salary packages that we have by 4%. We've increased the number of novated leases under management by 10%. We've delivered on a number of strategic priorities. And then on the sustainability front, we're very proud of our ESG credentials. And during the half, we received a rating from Sustainalytics of 8.6%, which put us in the 98th percentile globally in respect of ESG credentials. And we're also ranked in the 92nd percent from S&P in their sustainability index. This is an important aspect of our business, balancing with the other commercial aspects as well. And just to round off in terms of the outlook, from a trading perspective, since the release of our half-yearly results, July performance has been broadly in line with the rest of the half and up strongly on the prior period. That's been underpinned by good order volumes and good settlement volumes as well. Despite there is some commentary in the market about some potential macroeconomic headwinds, but we feel that we're well placed at the moment in a competitive environment. As I said, we delivered one of the largest client contracts in the country that we won last year, and we're continuing to make steady progress on our strategic priorities within the business, including the digitization and simplification of processes that we have. Again, just wanted to thank you for giving me the opportunity. Hopefully, that gave a good flavor of who Smartgroup is, what we're up to, and what we're achieving. Appreciate being here and really look forward to questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Jason. We do have some questions coming through. Probably got time for a couple of them. And I think you've touched on most of them, but we'll get through them anyway. So vehicle fleet management is quite different. It's quite a different business to the salary packaging business. How do these businesses complement each other, and why shouldn't the vehicle business be sold off? And I think you touched on, you know, that it is a lucrative business, albeit a small one.
So it's not the largest part of our business, but it is profitable, and it gives us very good returns. I guess from a synergies perspective, and dealing directly with the question of like, why is it not being separated? There is definitely overlap there in the client base. So where we are looking to provide services to employers through salary packaging and novated leasing, it is an extension on those services to be able to provide fleet management. So in our client base, there is a lot of overlap. And by offering these services in combination, I guess we're able to achieve a higher share of wallet, if you would call it that, for the clients, and to do so in a way that actually generates good returns for us and for the shareholders.
Great. Thank you for that. With the increasingly constant restructuring and redundancy seen in the public service sector, along with the trend away from permanent staff towards short-term temporary contracts, is this reducing your client base?
That's a really interesting question. I think probably the honest answer there is no. I think we tend to see the client segments we operate in particular government, as being relatively stable on the whole. And I'm sure that, you know, at the margin there is turnover, there is change. But in servicing these clients on the whole, that gives us access to, you know, very large pools of potential customers, and puts us in a strong position. Our focus there really is on maintaining and differentiating ourselves through customer service and retaining those clients. Because many of them are quite large clients. We aren't seeing too much disruption when it comes from external forces like redundancies or that sort of thing at the moment.
Okay, great. You're guiding for CapEx of 11 to 13 million in calendar year 24. What are you using CapEx for?
Thanks again. Good question. So in essence, it's really targeted towards the digital transformation, the ongoing investment in simplification of our processes, and a lot of the alignment activities we're undertaking. I didn't go into it deeply, but Smartgroup has had a history of growth through a number of acquisitions. And we think there's opportunity for efficiency and cost improvement through aligning a lot of back of house activities, including the brands. So we've announced an alignment of brand to the Smart brand. And that's something we'll be working on delivering over the coming couple of years. And really, a lot of the CapEx investments focus on the transformation and the digital.
Great. I think we'll have time for one more quick one. How are you simplifying your product suite? What are the main drivers?
So probably an extension on the previous question there. So because of the number of brands we currently maintain, effectively five active brands, and the way that we've grown as a business over recent years, there is the opportunity for us to simplify and align many processes. And that ranges from the very simple, so you know, reducing the number of branded forms that we have on the one end, to the quite complex, which involves amalgamation of systems, amalgamation of other back of house processes. And with that will come effectively efficiencies either in more scalable growth or better cost efficiencies as well.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, Jason. It was a great presentation.
Thank you.
And yeah, that brings us to the end of the day. So thank you so much.
Thank you.